So welcome everyone. Thank you for joining on a weekday. Hope everyone is healthy and happy. So we DailyTUG is a community basically for the Tableau enthusiast or data enthusiast as a all. We have been organizing meetups for last 2 years. For all the Tableau enthusiasts. So we started with in-person meetups, but due to COVID situation, we had to move to a virtual setup. So we have been doing this virtual meetup since last May. So I'll just take it through the motto, what our group is for. So we, a group of enthusiastic professionals from different organizations, are joined together to learn, share anything and everything related to Tableau. So it's been a setup that we have been meeting almost every 2 months, once every 2 months. So speakers are from different organizations. So today we have got Prashant Datta from Tableau and Avdesh Gaur from Ameriprise Financial Services. This is our core team. So this is myself, Lakshya Dhamecha. I am leading DailyTUG currently. Then we have Lakshmi Shamla and Ravi Gajula leading Hyderabad TUG. And Chetna and Nisha have been a part of core team as well for the DailyTUG. So these have been our speakers over past 2 years. So we have got some regular speakers like Manish Kumar, Abhay, Chetna, Ravi, then Anil. These are glimpses of all the meetups we have had over past 2 years, which were in person. So we have organized our meetups in CP at Shri Jan's office, then in Sapient and Fidelity's office in Gurgaon, and also Thought Focus's office in Gurgaon. So it's been a trend that we meet for discussing Tableau, and after that we generally go out for lunch or we get lunch at the office itself. So not taking more time, I'll just introduce you to today's speakers. So we have Prashant from Tableau and Avdesh from Ameriprise Financial Services. Avdesh will be taking you through how to design and present modern dashboards. Prashant will take you through certain concepts of LOD and basic calculations in Tableau. So handing over to Avdesh. Avdesh,
yeah, thanks Lakshya. So yeah, am I audible enough?
Yeah, you are audible. I'll just all right, stop so my screen share.
Sure, definitely. Thereafter I'll be sharing mine. Let me know once you can see it up.
Yeah, sure. Yes, Avdesh.
So your screen is all right, it's up, right?
Yeah.
All right. So first of all, a very good evening to everyone. Thank you all for attending and sparing time from your normal schedule. And what a nice way we can say to close another week other than a Tableau user group meetup. And on the same note, I would like to thank the organizers for providing us this opportunity to connect even virtually as well. We have had a lot of sessions out there at Fidelity and other offices, and we learned a lot. And these ones are certainly different, but yeah, again, serving the same motto as Lakshya mentioned. So in the first half of today's Connect, we'll learn about designing modern dashboards and that too with Tableau. And along with that, we'll be using PowerPoint to create the supporting stuff like creating icons in order to provide depth, or you can say, if you want to stress upon certain KPIs, then yeah, using the icons as well as other stuff, you can certainly do that. That will be designing using the PowerPoint. Apart from that, backdrops and other stuff, in order to make it look like the web apps, certainly the modern web apps that we have, we'll be using that again. We'll not just cover the fundamentals alone, but we'll have a detailed demo as well, certainly on how to do the same. Moving ahead, let's have a quick sneak peek of what we'll be creating today. So this is the dashboard that I created over the last weekend, and I didn't really got much of a time, so it's still not that complete, but I'll be completing it up out there on the upcoming weekends, and certainly we'll be posting a link of the interactive one out there over LinkedIn. You can certainly get in touch with me out there and utilize the same over Tableau Public. But yeah, today we'll definitely be going through how to design this particular landing page using Tableau, and yeah, several stuff using PowerPoint and other sources as well. We will be covering this up in four detail-oriented steps. And after this session, you'll certainly be able to design modern dashboards, again, more towards the infographic or more towards the today's web apps that we have in place. Moving ahead, let's have a close look or an overview of what all we'll be going through in the first half. The very first starting step is the storyboarding process. Whenever we try to implement certain project or try to create a dashboard, there is a storyline behind it. And the initial step is to literally go to the whiteboard, pick up your pen and paper, and start sketching your design. When I say design, I certainly do not mean the layout or the overview or the look and feel of that particular dashboard, but the entire functionality, including the navigation, how we'll go or drill down to the details and other stuff, so that it can be made or designed in the most intuitive manner, so that users can go through it without even a certain release note or a document on how to use this particular dashboard. We have been utilizing websites from quite a time since, I guess, for our generation, it's about 8th or 9th standards, means from when the internet was readily available. And we have been of the habit of that particular navigation stuff, of that particular drill down features. So that can be an inspiration to design the most intuitive manner, which can cover a larger audience for you without, or you can say in a hassle-free manner, in a nutshell. You can start up by creating a rough sketch that can certainly contain the KPIs, the metrics that you can come up with based on what exactly that project needs to come up with, or what's the end goal of that project is. Moreover, there can be eye candies for the KPIs as well that you can stress upon. You can provide weights as well in terms of the visual design, and that can be done in multiple manners. In brief, if we talk about, you can provide contrast to your KPIs. We'll be discussing this about in detail when we'll be having the demo process, and you'll be able to correlate to these points that I've been mentioning right now, that makes the starting process. You can provide weights to your KPIs by choosing appropriate fonts, certainly more bold fonts and bigger font sizes. We can create backdrops as well by creating backgrounds within PowerPoint, and certainly attention grabbing colors as well. There are a lot of other aspects as well that we can certainly utilize. And if we club all these ingredients in the most appropriate manner, then we can literally walk the users throughout our dashboard exactly the way we want to. And this certainly helps us to bring out the most appropriate story behind the data that we want to. Next we have the demo that is again broken up in 4 easy to execute steps. And as per the saying that mentions, magic seems to be sort of extraordinary unless or until you know the trick behind it. And that's what we are going to do in this particular demo. We'll be getting to know how exactly we can approach each and every step. And yeah, utilizing that, you can certainly design dashboards based on your creativity, the inspiration that you get from a lot of online designs. Day by day, we come across a lot of infographics, a lot of visuals that we even see on TV and other stuff while browsing even the social media. That can also be used up as an inspiration to design certain chunks and parts of our dashboards. Moving ahead, after the demo, we'll be discussing in brief about the best practices, certainly for visual design and storytelling, and followed by the tools and resources that can make our life sort of super easy. And otherwise, it can reduce certain burden from our end as far as creating a better UI is concerned. Thereafter, you'll be meeting up my co-creators, and finally, we'll be summing up all with the due credits that we have utilized the stuff such as the color palettes and other design aspects. So that will go through in the end. But before that, let me give you a brief round of introduction about myself. I'm a data analyst, an instructor, author, and a storyteller as well when it comes to bringing insights out of data and presenting the story behind it. My career spans for more than 6 years with a focus on taking down various business requirements, certainly by building data-driven business intelligence models, by utilizing various tools such as Tableau, which is my core skill. Apart from that, I've been utilizing SQL, Python, and various other tools in order to massage the data and create the final output to support the dashboard creation. And thereafter, I've also been creating various statistical models and been utilizing various statistical data analysis techniques to come up with certain insights that that certainly create the key aspects of our dashboards. The last year, I got one of my submissions to Tableau accepted as well, which we call the Viz of the Day as well. In that particular viz, I talked about the opportunities or certain processes by which we can create efficient dashboards wherein the users does not require to wait that long and can create a balanced trade-off between the design, the usability, as well as the speed. That you can certainly check out at my Tableau public profile. It's still available out there. And yeah, means 4 or 5 years back when I initially started with Tableau and other stuff, there was a time when I couldn't really even figure out what's something new that I can do tomorrow. What's something new that can be achieved within Tableau. But yeah, as it's means everyone says with sheer practice and with time going by, you can certainly learn a lot of stuff. And that's the reason I feel immense joy in creating and sharing the content that can help us learn something new each day. Talking about some of my great experiences that I have had recently, I've authored certain courses with PACT. And the recent one is Storytelling with Tableau that was published last to last month on 15th of May, 2020. If I talk more about it, then presenting the insights based on our analysis is as important as coming up with these fruitful ones. We spend a lot of time in analyzing our data and coming up with these data-driven insights. At the end of the day, when you are creating your visualizations, that should be given due importance and due time, so that everything that you have spent so much time on till now can be really materialized. And even though the same can be taken care of in multiple ways, we can say, but storytelling when combined with your insights makes it quite presentable as well as impactful as well. Moreover, it provides you certain advantages and the opportunities as well to you and your audience to create active participation as well. The more interactive, the more intuitive your dashboards will be, the more easy and better it will be for the user to drill down and go and check out the details by themselves. In that particular manner, utilizing the progressive depth, we can certainly create more interest within the users when it comes to creating dashboard design. And how we can do that? So yeah, there the promotional stuff comes up. You can certainly go and check out the same course. I have talked about quite in detail regarding the same. And yeah, means there is a 10-day trial at Pluralsight. You can certainly take advantage of that. It's a 2-hour course, and you can certainly cover it up free of cost if you are willing to. Moving ahead, I really love traveling and exploring new places, which from the last month I'm not able to. And I'm really hoping the current situation comes to an end and we are able to join back to the normal TUG sessions that we used to have had in Gurgaon and other places out there in Delhi. After that, I'm quite active over LinkedIn and Tableau Public. If in case you want to get in touch with me, you can connect with me over these platforms. Moving ahead, if you want to know more, even more about me, then certainly Google these three words, Avdhesh Gaur Tableau, and you'll get to know a lot about me. Moving ahead, if you try to find me, then these are my avatars over various platforms. This is what I looks like over LinkedIn, Tableau Public, and Twitter. This is me over Pluralsight. And last but not the least, Pinterest, which I certainly uses a lot. That's what I am over Pinterest. And I'm not really sure what I've been doing at that time. Maybe browsing the Pinterest as well. So moving ahead, we'll certainly be taking up few quotes. This is quite a famous one, that design is not just what it looks like or how it feels. Certainly design is how it works. And that's what we are going to take up out there in the upcoming demo. And this one was by Steve Jobs. It's not a quote, but it's a saying that I follow up with. I surf Pinterest for ideas and design with pen and paper instead of certain tools and softwares. That way we can really discard our designs with least minimal of dissatisfaction and crumble up the paper and throw it out there in the dustbin. This one is by me. Moving ahead, we have a design process that we are going to follow. And that certainly is broken up by the into four easy steps that I already mentioned, or four easy pieces. The very first one is the storyboarding one. We need to draw up our sketches. We need to design the dashboard. And thereafter, we can certainly start building the same stuff out there in Tableau. The second one, as been mentioned, is creating your Tableau template, which includes your KPIs, your charts, then various text boxes and other stuff that you need to incorporate in order to make it more intuitive and to impart the best knowledge out of it that you are trying to implement. The third one is we can utilize certain other tools like Adobe Illustrator, we have Figma, and the most easily available one out there in the organizations is PowerPoint. So in this particular session, we'll be utilizing that to design or draw over our Tableau template. And finally, we'll be summing up all or combining up all in order to create the entire dashboard. So let's quickly move up to the demo. And Yeah, it's the time to pick up the brush wherein we can see things in action. I'll quickly move to the Tableau part. So this is the very first. So I've been utilizing the Superstore dataset, and I've tried to create a very simple design, and this is certainly the landing page, and thereafter we can have multiple pages for the detailed views as well. Right now, the very first step I could have implemented over pen and paper as well, but yeah, means I certainly created a rough sketch, and thereafter I created the same out there in Tableau. Reason being, I'm gonna use this as a template to create the backdrops in PowerPoint. So over to the left, we have got the navigation bar. We'll have four icons over here: the home button, then an icon for total sales, an icon for total quantity, then for total profit. Thereafter, at the bottom, we'll have a icon to expand the navigation menu, just like we have out there in the web apps. I'll quickly show you how it will be. And if we'll click over here, there will be a menu that will open up, and that will give you the details that this is the home button. This is, by clicking on this, you can go to total sales for a detailed overview. You can go to how much quantities have been sold till now, what are the insights about it, and what are the other stuffs that we have analyzed so far in quite some detail by navigating to this particular page. And finally, we have the total profits. And yeah, if we again want to come back, this button can be utilized to come back to this particular page. So again, it's not certainly about how it looks, but how intuitive the design can be based on how easily the users can move between different pages without even thinking about it for more than a second. How exactly I can go back from where I came. So that's what design is, according to me. And yeah, Steve Jobs as well. Certainly we can collapse this if it's no longer required. Coming back to the very first step. Over the top, I've given a header. Again, it can be based on the dashboard that you have been creating. The simplest one that I can think of is Superstore dashboard, and certain details about the Superstore dataset. Thereafter, I have thought of three, you can say, palettes or backdrops, you can say, or you can say cards as well, wherein we'll have a single card for sales, quantity, and profits. Over the top of each card, I thought of icons representing each quantity as it is. And certainly icons must be intuitive, so that it should certainly correlate with the KPI that you are trying to put up. And thereafter, I have a detailed trend of the same KPI as well, how things have been moving back and forth over different quarters for sales, then for quantity, and finally for profits. So this is certainly, you can consider as a rough sketch, even over a pen and paper. And if designed over Tableau, this is what it looks like. Moving on to the second one, herein we create the icons and other stuff that makes it sort of look complete. And yeah, the navigation and other functionalities can also be incorporated out here. So there are a lot of options wherein you can find icons over the web, and you can create your own as well. The very first one is quite simple one, but is not that impactful and effective. Reason being, different icons may be found over different sources, and those may not be the similar looking ones. I'll give you an example by quickly moving to the workspace. So these are the icons that I've designed out there in PowerPoint, and certainly means some of them have been inspired from some ones that I've browsed over the web. So I'll quickly bring up the tray icon or the quantity icon that I've utilized. But certainly when I put this against the one that I've utilized for total profits, which is nothing else but a circle. I'll quickly show you how it's done. So go to shapes, select a oval, select it, create it, then you can go to format shape, select a particular size so that it appears like a square. For simplicity, let's choose 5x5. Go to shape fill, make it none. Shape outline, you can make it white. And then weights, you can select accordingly. Let's make it 4.5. And thereafter, what you can do is, you can, in order to bring up the dollar sign, you can pick up a text box, and that can be utilized to put up the dollar sign over here, and the appropriate fonts you can select. Thereafter, the appropriate colors and the alignment you can select, and based on that, yeah, there can be a quick icon that you can come up with. So this is how this was designed. And if I make it slightly smaller, this is how quickly you can design icons within PowerPoint. And if you'll select it all by right clicking over it, you can group it up so that it can be a single picture. And thereafter, you can export it up by right clicking over it. Just give me a moment. By save as picture over here, and you can save it as a PNG image, which can be utilized out there over your dashboard. So yeah, talking about this was quite bold, and the other one was not that one. So I created a similar one again using the same stuff we have got. So I'll quickly ungroup it, and then you'll be able to see on how it was created. So it consists of various lines aligned accordingly. Plus is again made up of different lines. This is basically nothing else but this particular shape, wherein you can, it's the curve that you can design accordingly or create accordingly. And two circles, filled circles. And yeah, you have a shopping cart out there, which can be utilized as an icon in your dashboard. Again, for this, I started up initially with this one. I didn't really like it much. I moved it to this one. For these lines, the transparency have been reduced to around 50%, so that it acts up as a drop line instead of the entire chart, so that we can differentiate between the line chart and the drop lines. So these are the minor variations that you can make in order to create an impact or to make it look more better than what it can be. Again, this is a box with a plus sign, and similarly the same one. And once you have created all of your icons, all that you require is to put these up and import these up as an image out here, and align it properly so that each and every icon is sort of aligning and is of the same size. And apart from that, what we can make sure of is the center alignment and the separators, so that they can be sort of distinct between or the navigation can appear sort of perfect when we'll move to the backdrops. So coming up from this step to this step, and I'll quickly go to the normal view. And this particular dashboard is made up of 4 sheets. So I'll quickly unhide these. And we have got total sales over here, which is again this one. Then we have the trend lines over there for again the sales over the order dates. We have got total quantity again summed up at an overall level. Then again, we have the same for quantity, followed by profits, and the same for profits. And everything else apart from it is being developed using the other tools. which can really support Tableau in order to build better looking or the modern dashboard, you can say. I'll hide it again and we'll go back to the presentation mode. So now coming on to step three, how we can transition from step two to step three with minimal efforts. And means that the very first thing that comes to our mind is we need to create a backdrop that is exactly the same size of this particular box, and similarly a navigation bar that aligns with this, so that it can be put up out there behind these, and it can certainly come up, the text and everything can certainly come up based on the contrast and can stand out really well. So how can we create it so that it matches exactly based on these heights and widths? One step can be we can note out the pixels density or the width and height for each and every box. That is the very first thing that comes to our mind and can create with the same aspect ratio within PowerPoint. But another easy step would be you can export your dashboard and it will create a image for it. Once you'll save it, a image will be a PNG image or JPEG image will be saved out there for this dashboard. And now what you can do is if you'll go back to your canvas, I'll create a duplicate for this, quickly delete these things. Now, as we discussed, so you can import this particular image in PowerPoint. And as we discussed, the third step was drawing over the template that you have created out there in Tableau. And that can be done quite easily over here without thinking much about the height, width, and the aspect ratio or the pixels that we have had out there in Tableau. You can skip all the maths and you can certainly draw it based on this particular template out here. So thinking about of these backdrops, these are nothing else but the shapes that we have picked up from this particular palette itself. First of all, we'll start up by drawing this particular navigation bar. I'll quickly take this up and we'll paste it over here to pick up the colors. I'll move it over here. What we can do is we can select the shape, and it can be this particular rectangle with rounded corners, and we can start up with the borders of this particular navigation template that we have created and create a box like this. Then all we require is to format the fill as well as the outline. Either we can this is the fill, so we can certainly, so yeah, you can choose the colors from various online sources that we'll be discussing later on. And I'll also provide the source from where I have taken these color codes and palettes at the end. But yeah, before that, I'm certainly utilizing the one that I have created for the color references. So this is, as we can see in the hover over here, it's having the RGB value as 46, 48, and 52. And we'll be picking it up and we'll be moving it to no outline. We'll just be arranging it up. And that's how you can create the navigation backdrop. This was the easiest one that we can create using PowerPoint. The second one, as you can see within our dashboard, are these backdrops, which is having, if you look closely, then over the top we are having a darker shade of this particular color, and down below we are trending or diverging to a certainly different bright color of the same shade, which is certainly providing an appeal to this particular backdrop, instead of if we had gone through with the same color gradient from top to bottom. So we'll discuss both. Let's create this one, but before that, let me copy this so that I can utilize the same for color references. I'll remove this and paste it over here. We'll move this right over here. And then for creating the very first one, what you can do is you can select a rectangle with blunt corners. And again, you can start drawing by based on that particular template itself. All we need to do is fill up the shape with that particular color. So we'll pick it up from here. Right now it's a solid color. We do not even have a gradient, not even have a multicolored gradient that we'll be taking up later on. And outlines, we can skip it up right now. We have a perfect shape right now. And if you go to shape effects, then what you can do is, we'll come back to this later on. But yeah, let's discuss the gradient part first. Coming up to the gradient part, there are different gradients already been provided by PowerPoint over here. And this is the one that is darker over the left corner and quite lighter of the same shade over the bottom right corner. And this is the one that is darker at the top and quite light at the bottom. But it is not even close enough to what it is over here. And certainly is not that appealing as compared to this one. So how can we move from this to this? There is a simple step. All we need to do is right click on it, format shape. And over here, under fill option, we have this gradient fill already selected because we have selected a single colored gradient. And right now we have linear selected. We have radial, rectangular, and other options as well. We'll go ahead with linear. We'll not be modifying other options. And angle basically defines how the gradient varies from top to bottom of this particular sheet. Right now we have selected top to bottom, so it will be varying from top to bottom based on this particular angle. Right now it's 90 degrees, so it will be straight. As I want to move from this corner to this corner, I want to make it around 250 degrees. So this will be the darker shade and this will be the lighter shade that I'll be selecting. So in order to select the colors, so this represents the top left corner and this represents the bottom right corners as of now, because I am almost into three times that of 90. In order to perfectly align with corners, you can select 270 degrees. And with 360 degrees, it will be from left to right. Selecting the colors for these is as simple as picking up the colors that you have already chosen. I'll be taking it up from the one that I've created. Then I'll be picking up the second one somewhere from around here. The third one with somewhere around here. I'd like to add some more. So the fourth and fifth one, I'll try to make it certainly light. And the color I'll be picking up would be from over here. And for the last one, I'll choose from the bottom right section. I have chosen the wrong one. So from this one. And if we move it slightly to the left, the gradient will increase and it will be more close to this. We can even make it better based on the choice of colors that we come up with. And yeah, it really depends upon your creativity and the source of inspiration that you are creating it with. And based on that, you can create really, really cool backdrops. And similarly, we can try to create out for these as well. I'll just create one more for you so that you are quite familiar with the process. I'll try to be as quick as with this without wasting much of the time over the same thing. The next step would be, so one step we forgot in this, pardon from my end, but over here in the dashboard, if you look closely, there has been a shadow over the right hand side and over the bottom end section. In order to produce a shadow, go to shape effects. From the shadow, select the one that you really like or that you really feel is appealing based on this particular card. As it's quite long in length, so I would like to provide a shadow to either of the height, and along with that, the base will go really great. Reason being, if we'll be following the same process for the last one, it will impart a ending section to this particular dashboard, and it will certainly feel like it's sort of ending over here. If in case we have had the entire screen covered, this would create a boundary for your dashboard. And similarly, you can create a left backdrop and bottom backdrop for your navigation as well. But to maintain the consistency, I had gone ahead with the right and bottom shadow backdrop for this. So yeah, we have covered the effect part as well. Coming up to this, again, go to gradient fill, select linear. It's already 250 degrees. All we need to do is select the colors. Select the color palettes based on the selections that you have already come up with. And you can see the shape has started to fill accordingly. Thereafter, based on the other lighter shades, you can certainly go with more than two colors as well if you want to really make it stand out from one end to another, or if you have a certain KPI that you want to stress upon over the top, you can make it a darker shade, and towards the bottom, if you feel that's not so impactful information or as compared to the above one. So that's how you can go ahead with these gradients in order to provide a weight to the most important KPI that you feel should be provided a weight to based on contrast. So that's the first thing that grabs the user's attention in the very first go. So selecting up, I guess this is the last one that we have. We'll choose it from here. And yeah, based on the same, we have a gradient. In the similar fashion, we can create the third one as well. And the last step would be to create some texts or some other stuff over here, like I have created in this for learn more. And this can be utilized as a navigation button to go to the detailed page of total quantity, total sales, and then to the total profits page as well. And thereafter, we can utilize these ones as well. So we are providing multiple options for the users to navigate and a single one to come back to the home page if they want to. So to create this one, what we'll do is again we'll select a rounded square, rounded rectangle over here. Based on the aspect ratios, we can define it. The shape outline will be white. In our case, we really want it to stand out over this darker shade at the background. And then shape fill can be no fill. Again, the shape outline seems to be quite thin. We can put up the weights over here. One seems fine. Then comes the text part that we can fill in over here. We had learn more in that particular box. The text appears to be somewhat larger than the box. We can have more white spaces between the text and the box. So I would like to reduce the font size and would like to make it 16 or 14. I'll like to make it 15. So you can see, like, if you are quite picky about the fonts and even the white spaces, the minimal of the white spaces, you'll see the difference between 14, 15 and 16 as well. Again, I learned it from the clients who were quite picky, and thereafter I also became the same. Means, yeah, it's the company that modifies you, not the organization that you're working with, but yeah, the people that you are working with. So yeah, I really learned a lot from my previous colleagues, and I'm really learning a lot from my current colleagues. So that's how we learn. And the same again goes ahead with the user group, Tableau user group. We are taking it a step further. We are learning from other firms' representatives as well. So that's why I really like this platform. So that's what we can do. We can control, copy it, then duplicate it using Control D, and then really move it up. Select this one and move it up out here. Align it up easily over here. And similarly, we can do it for the third shape as well. And once we have created everything of it, what we can do is we can either group, select each one of it. Just a moment. Select each one of it along with the text boxes and right click on it and click group. But I would certainly not like to group everything at once. Reason being, I'll let you know, going back to this particular dashboard. When I was designing this particular expand section, I wanted it to feel like it's coming from this particular navigation bar from left to right. And that's why I wanted this particular. So this is nothing else but a container. And this is the button that is hiding and expanding this particular container. So I wanted this container to feel like it's expanding from this navigation menu and it's collapsing back to this one. So that's why I wanted the container behind this particular navigation menu, but at the same time, in front of this particular three dropdowns that we have created for sales, quantity, and profit. So that's why I want the navigation menu to be exported separately and all other stuff as a separate one so that I can move it in front and behind using this option of floating back and forward in Tableau. So what we'll do is we'll again export this, save as picture, and then export it. And then everything else will be clubbing up all together by using control and selects. And thereafter, what we can do is we can right click on it and group it. Right now it's already grouped, so it's showing an option to ungroup. And thereafter, what you can do is again, you can right click on this grouped icon, save it as a picture. And once you have it, so this is what your stuff will look like. This is what background one will be like that we have exported. It will be having the backdrops along with learn more icons. If you want to use these icons as a button, you can do it with two options. Either use a transparent button in Tableau with a transparent image PNG and put it over it so that it feel like you are really clicking on this learn more button, but it will take you to another dashboard. Or you can literally export these buttons as a separate image and then put it up over here. But that would require you to properly align it in Tableau, and you need to manage the height and means the exact height and the exact width and y-axis for each and every button. That will be an added work to you. So yeah, I would certainly like to go ahead with a blank button so that yeah, the previous the icons that we have behind it are still visible, but yeah, the buttons can also be implemented using that. So moving ahead, the second one was this particular navigation bar. So we had these two particular backdrops created separately, and the next step would be from this step two to step three is what we'll do is we'll go to images and we'll right now it's styled. I'll make it floating first and then we'll go to it. You can choose the image that you want to come up as the background. Select center and fit image. It will be easier for you to put it up out there in the background. Move it to the back. And now all we need to do is we need to align it up with the one that we have built over here. So drag it up so that it covers the entire space, and we can move to the layout to move it accordingly so that it's as per our template. And the x-axis can also be adjusted. I guess we have we need to increase the width, but at the same time we need to reduce the height so that it's perfectly aligned, somewhat more y-axis and a little bit of x. So it's almost close to what we have provided out there in the template. Now, similarly, in the same fashion, we can import this particular navigation tab as well. I'll quickly do that. And again, the same steps you need to follow and import the image, hit OK. And thereafter, select the height and the width accordingly so that it's matching the one that you have created. Move it to the back so that your icons are really visible and the dashboard has started coming up based on what we have as the final picture. Again, we can manage the height, width and everything accordingly so that each and every template background is perfectly aligning to the image that you have created so far. So yeah, it's sort of a time consuming process if you strictly wanted to align it to what you have created. And based on the scene, you can create the exact layout that you have designed up. So it's almost matching then what we have put up. The next step is nothing else but to remove these redundant boxes that we had created for the design. This is done. Right now, I have not implemented this particular vertical box that basically is coming behind from it. What we can do is we can choose the background from more colors so that the color is matching this one, and we hit OK. We move the background transparency to 90% so that our other stuff is sort of barely visible. Again, it will feel like it's coming from the back of this particular image. We can move it to front, and thereafter we will be required to move the icons to the front as well. That will be a hectic job. I won't be doing it right now. Thereafter, you can, in order to implement or provide these particular navigation icons so that if you'll click over this, it will take you to the detail page. What you can do is you can pull it up. So I'll quickly copy. Right now it's a text and certainly do not want it as a text because navigation cannot be implemented in that particular fashion. What we can do is we can put it up buttons over here, which after a certain version, it was buttons in 2020.1, I guess, or 2, or prior to that, and thereafter it has been moved to navigation. So yeah, means the very first time I was really struggling where they have moved the buttons, but here it is. So you can choose it either as an image button if you wanted to, or the easy option would be to go ahead with a text one. Right now, I want the title to be home with certain spaces at the left hand side so that if we can also put it at the center, it won't be that great. Means as per my choice, your choice can be different based on what you have been creating. So this is what we can do, and we can select the font size and everything accordingly, the text colors and other stuff. And we can choose anything to means, yeah, as the final navigation option that we wanted to navigate to. It's not that dark. I'll make it bold and I'll improve the font size as well. 14. So looks good. Now what we can do is we can move it to this particular box and we can choose the height accordingly so that certainly it comes up sort of aligned with this particular icon. And similarly, we can put other stuff out here. And at the end, if any information and other things that you want to incorporate, like I have incorporated over here based on the creators. So that's how you can certainly create the navigation, the backdrops, the weights for it, the icons along with other stuff that can be utilized out here in Tableau in order to make your visualizations quite great. So I'll quickly show you how exactly we have moved and from where we have moved to where. We started up with just a minute. I need a sip of water. I have been speaking from last 45 minutes. Thank you. This was the first step we started up with. The step zero would be a sketch over the pen and paper. We call it the storyboarding process. The second one is the same. You try to implement it out here in Tableau with your KPIs, the weights, the font sizes, and there are a lot of stuff that you really need to decide beforehand. Means if I go to the details, even the ratio or the margin of this particular navigation from the left hand side and these distances between each backdrop, I have sort of kept it exact to the lowest pixel that is available out here. So the width is 310 and height is this one, and the gap between these two is 50 pixels. Thereafter, the gap over here is again 50 pixels. Over the left, we have 25 and this is 70 pixels. And I've been working over it from quite some time. I can remember it. So again, if you'll be designing the same stuff, you'll remember these numbers as well. If you want to go ahead with this one. Again, you can modify things based on your choice and how you want your layout to be, based on the heights, based on the dashboard layout that you have chosen up with. So how exactly I came up with these numbers? I knew I had a navigation at the left. Then I had three boxes out over here. And my dashboard width was 900 pixels. So what I did was this, I did manually, the left 25 and the 70. So it makes up 95. Thereafter, I thought of at least 45 or 50 you need over here so that to maintain a decent white space between navigation and your first card. Thereafter, what I did was I dragged from over here to here. So what exactly is the width? It's around 1128. I divided, I removed these margins 50-50 again. It was around 930, 940, something like that. Divided it by three. And I came up with 310 for each box. If you want to be precise, you can do that. If you do not want, you can make it a rough one as well. So that's up to you. Again, the more details you'll be including, the more professional and better it will look. But again, these are the things that require most of the efforts. At the end, it may not feel like we have spent a lot of effort over here, but certainly when you will be designing it, you'll be coming across these minor details. And if you'll be taking care of each and everything of that, then certainly you'll be spending a lot of time with Tableau. And thereafter, you'll be getting to know why Tableau is providing these features to us. And initially, when I started using Tableau, I didn't really felt this particular left layout box of that importance. But later on, when I started implementing other stuffs, I really felt like life would not have been that hassle-free or easy without this. So there is a reason why Tableau provides certain color palettes, why it provides certain options. And moreover, if you feel like it can be improved, we can certainly raise our queries over community forums. And the best part about Tableau that I like is our queries are really addressed. And the last to last time when I was attending the Tableau conference, although virtually, I really wanted to attend in person someday, and I would be. But meanwhile, we are getting this opportunity to attend it virtually. I saw this feature, which was sort of introduced, the auto updation of the parameters, which was not really available before that. And I have seen a lot of requests out there in Tableau forums, and there have been a lot of upvotes, and Tableau really implemented it quite quick. And that's something I really appreciate working with Tableau. Initially, I had a choice between other tools as well. And I'm quite pleased to say that I chose Tableau over the other ones. And I'm really feeling great working with the community that Tableau provides, working with the other features and inspirations that we can draw from a lot of creators over LinkedIn. And yeah, the sessions like these are of sheer importance that I really feel great of my association with Tableau. Now, yeah, a lot of appreciation for Tableau I've done, but yeah, I really mean it. Moving ahead, where were we? So yeah, we were talking about different features for Tableau. I guess this is pretty much it. And this is how we can design great dashboards. This was quite a simple one. And if we go into detail, we can create quite relevant dashboards within our organization, provided you are sticking to your brand colors, if that is required. Thereafter, there are certain aspects that really we need to take care of. But yeah, even after that, we can create great stuff with Tableau. And yeah, means initially when I saw stuff like this, when it really started to came up, there were several authors like Ratnesh Pandey, and then there were Pradeep as well, who started building dashboards utilizing these images and other stuff from the tools like Adobe Illustrator, combining Tableau with other tools, improving the overall capability and other stuff. I always wondered how exactly these dashboards have been designed. And I really went up to the creators, asked them how you did it. And they were quite great about sharing their thoughts over it, what tools they have used, what inspirational sources they have used. And I'm really thankful to all the creators that who acts as a source of inspiration for all of us. And this one, I would really like to put it up to Ratnesh Pandey. He is a Tableau featured author. And the colors, the color palette, as well as the design have been taken up from Ratnesh. So a big thanks to him. I'll also be mentioning the details about him out there in the credits when we'll go back to slides. But yeah, I was talking to him quite some time before, and he was also really excited about this being utilized in this forum to showcase how things are being done and be taken up to the next level than what we can think of. And definitely after some time, we'll be having pretty great designs out there, and we'll be having some more sessions wherein we'll be learning how exactly we can do that with Tableau. So yep, these questions will always be coming up with great dashboards shared over LinkedIn and other whiz of the day stuff. Moving back to the presentation part, we have done Tableau. Sorry, we have done the demo. And moving ahead, I would like to talk about some of the best visual practices that can help us create, I would not say a great design, but a design that is soothing to the user. The more better the design is, the more are the chances the user will be spending the due time that you at least deserve based on your efforts that you have put in creating that dashboard. Creating a dashboard takes up a lot of time frames, sometimes varying from weeks till months based on what exactly we want to achieve. And at the end of the day, we certainly want our efforts to be materialized in the best possible manner. And these practices certainly help us to do that. Although these are some minor details, but certainly if you try utilizing or implementing this, you'll feel the impact as you compare the before and after. The very first one can be choosing the happening color palette. And by happening color palette, what I mean is, there should be, if we talk about colors, we can really go in quite some depth based on, is the color palette monochromatic or are they contrasting colors, or there can be a lot of features about colors that we can really study about. And I have been doing that from, means these minor things I have been studying from the last two and a half years, and till now I really feel these topics quite fascinating. If we talk about quite obvious ones, then yeah, red seems alerting, green seems something good. And there is really more to it when we go ahead and study more about colors. So yeah, I would really encourage you to learn more about it. Try to find online sources, white papers published by Tableau. You can find it at tableau.com, and those are really, really great. I appreciate those. And those can really make you learn a lot of things which you may not find out in quite some detail over some of the video lectures or other stuff. Yeah, video lectures and all are quite great when it comes to getting or learning a new skill. But if you want to get into the details, I would really like to recommend the text-based versions like white papers and other stuff for these options. Moving ahead, white spaces, although it may not seem that important, but certainly improves readability and then create your designs quite impactful. If we go back to our viz, suppose we do not maintain a proper white space, we increase this, and then we put it over here and put it over here. Thereafter, we have this chart after a lot of space, and thereafter learn more. This does not look that great as compared to this one. Or what I think is, I still feel that this one can be improved a lot by having a hidden trials, just by moving everything by 1 pixels, looking at it. Does it feel or look better? Based on your intuition, you can certainly choose the white spaces that you feel are quite great. Moving back, the third one is the icons. We could have gone ahead without utilizing the icons with the KPIs. I would certainly recommend the icons, at least with the KPIs that you are having with the dashboard. You can search it out over the web. You can use certain sites, the paid ones, if you are willing to. And if you certainly feel like you are not able to find anything out there, you can put your own creativity into picture and create these icons on your own. There are a lot of courses. You don't know PowerPoint, if you don't know Adobe Illustrator, you can go for these courses and improve your skills. In the long run, I can guarantee you these skills will definitely help you to create a difference. It's not just the insights that makes everything quite great, but the design as well. And that's what create a better looking design. The usage of icons, white space, color palettes, and at the last but not the least, the contrast. Again, if we want to go back to the dashboard, I've chosen the dark colors followed by lighter shades at the top of it so that it comes really well. On the other end, if I move it with a lighter background and then a darker font, it won't be certainly popping up right now, means as what it is popping up right now. So I'll quickly do it for you. We'll go to this, we'll adjust the font, make it black, and what we'll do is we'll go to dashboard quite quickly, we'll format it, we'll remove the shading and make it white. This does not seem quite appealing. Even if we move it or format it to some other color, that we may feel can be quite appealing. Green, a great color. It seems better than black, but I feel this one is more coming up as compared to the one that we discussed. Again, the choice, the opinions varies from person to person. You may like it. Chances are your stakeholders might not like it. And yeah, you need to move up accordingly. But with Tableau Public, we have the full-fledged opportunity. Therein, you can showcase your creativity. And yeah, it's a nice platform to put up your work. Then going back to the slides. Coming up to the sources. And if I have been utilizing, I guess I am up to the end. So I'll be wrapping it up in the next 2-3 minutes. I was willing to move you these sources as well. But yeah, for colors, you can choose canva.com, colors.co as well, white spaces. It's your intuition. For icons, you can go to Google it, or you can either use dribbble.com for inspiration. It's a paid one. And yeah, so you can look out for the inspiration from that. And Pinterest can be utilized for the design. You can find a lot of designs out there. And it's up to you how to what extent you are able to implement it up. Moving up to my co-creators, meet Abhinav God. He's a data enthusiast and he's a regular Makeover Monday practitioner. I have been mentoring him. And yeah, I mean, whenever I find time, I have a look at his visualizations. And he's in a learning stage. You can follow him as well if you like to, over LinkedIn and Tableau Public. So this is what he looks like over the same. Last but not the least, big thanks and kudos to Ratnish for the design credits. This is what he is like over LinkedIn and Tableau Public. You can follow him over the same. I've provided the links for his Tableau Public profile at the bottom. I'll be sharing the link to this particular slide as well. Moreover, Lakshya and Caroline will also be doing that. At the end, I wanted to share a story as well, which was behind this course. But yeah, if you really find like this session was great, I can assure you there is more to learn from this course as well. You can certainly go to Plural site. It depends on you whether you want to pay it or utilize the free 10-day trial. It's a 2-hour course. You can easily wrap it up within the weekend. So it's your choice. Moving up, the links are available over here. Otherwise, just Google Avdhesh God Tableau. There will be a lot coming out. The freeware stuff, other stuff related to Tableau that you may find relevant with respect to your learnings, depending upon how great you are with Tableau and the certain courses that I have authored till now. So this is the best one that even I recommend. The other one with PACT, I would not to that extent, but yeah, this is something that can create a difference. At the end, you can connect us with LinkedIn, Twitter, Tableau Public. Links are available out there in this particular deck. At the end, thank you all for joining, and over to you, Lakshya. It had been a great time. I didn't really thought I would be able to cover the entire 1 hour, but I had. So I would not like to move over. Over to you. Sharing.
Yeah. So thank you, Avdhesh. There are a few questions. Some of them we have already answered. Some of them Avdhesh will pick meanwhile. When Prashant will be presenting. So, and I would suggest everyone who has posted their questions onto the chat window, kindly post all your questions onto the Q&A section. So now we'll take a short 5 minutes break. So it is 5:49 now. We'll start exactly at 5:55 with the next session. I can see a few questions regarding where can people get in touch with together. So yes, we have a LinkedIn group for Tableau users named Delhi Tableau User Group. What I'll do, I'll share my screen. I'll share some sources where we can get in touch with. So we have our group on LinkedIn as well as Meetup and Twitter. I'll just share my screen and you can note down. Also, we'll be sharing this presentation later, so you can get in touch with whenever you receive the link for the same. So I'll just stop sharing my screen. Prashant, ready to go?
Yeah, Lakshya, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can.
Perfect. Let me quickly share my screen. Yes. And once that comes up, let me know.
Yeah, I can see your screen.
Lakshya, is the resolution all right, or would you want me to increase it a little?
If you can increase a little.
Yeah, just give me one second.
Yeah.
Okay, let me see if this closes and then open it back up again. Is it better now? Can you at least see the column headers and stuff?
Yes, I can see it.
Perfect. Yeah. Perfect. So I think then this should be fine. Cool. So should we start? Do we wait for another minute and give people just another couple of minutes to come back? Okay. Fine. Cool. So firstly, thank you so much, you know, for inviting me and you know, someone from Tableau. We don't do these events enough because we don't want to get involved directly with user group forums, but we do look forward to getting invited and you know, sharing you know, whatever the group wants to look at. Before I start my session today, you know, a big shout out to Avdesh for taking us through you know, the custom aspects for which Tableau is loved. The kind of stuff that I'm going to show you is very, very native. Tableau was built for that, but it's community members like Avdesh who actually gone out and, you know, gone beyond you know, these native capabilities and brought in you know, different ways in which and Tableau you know, usage can be enhanced. So Avdesh, thank you so much for taking that session. And you know, just like you, we love the fact that our users love our product, and we only strive to make it you know, better for you. If, you know, every time you go back to using Tableau. Now, having said that, I am not going to take a long time. It's Friday evening. I know you've had a very, very long week. Weeks have become longer now, especially because all of us work from home. So what I will do is I'll restrict my talk for about 30 to 40 minutes. And then if there are any questions for me, I would love to take those up. Like Lakshya said, please use the Q&A section to post in your questions. The topic that I'm going to pick up, both Avdesh and Lakshya, and I'm hoping that some of you who are attending this should be aware of. I'm not going to get into advanced usage of the calculations that I'm going to talk about today. And there are two topics that I'm going to cover, the level of detail expressions and table calculations. Both of these are fairly, you know, largely used by our users. Depending on what kind of a use case you have, there is a chance that as soon as you start using Tableau, there will be a point where you would want to use these calculations. Now, before we start or jump into level of details and table calcs, what is important to understand is how Tableau basically understands you know, details when it comes to the data that is being brought into Tableau. What you have in front of you right now is the Tableau canvas. What you are seeing here is the dimensions and measures, which is typically the data inputs that you know, come in when you connect to a data. Now, once you've got that data in, for both level of detail calculations and table calculations, what truly matters is what you bring into you know, the canvas itself. So the kind of things that you will put into rows and columns, which is nothing but your X and Y axis, your marks card, your filters, and your pages section. So any dimension or measure that is brought in basically lets Tableau then get into the details at, or the granularity of data that you're looking at. And what we are going to do today is essentially understand that, right? So I'm going to take you through some you know, different challenges and different use cases. It's typically show and tell. I would love to have had a more interactive session for this. But for now, what I'm going to truly concentrate on are the concepts behind this. So if you're somebody who's attending this right now and who knows how, you know, the basics of LODs and table calcs work, this is going to be more of a refresher for you, right? So pardon me for that. So let's kickstart this. And the first thing that we're going to cover today is the level of detail expressions. Now, level of detail expressions is basically a family of functions within Tableau, which lets you bring in granularity, irrespective of whether it's there in the visualization that you're building or not. A visualization could also be this table, right? So for Tableau, anything that starts getting built here on the canvas is a visualization, irrespective of whether it's actually a viz or a table, right? So I'm going to use that as a blanket terminology. Now, what you're seeing in front of you right now is what comes in, right? So, but before we get into this, let's start here and let's start from the basics. Now, what essentially happens in Tableau is once you start dragging and dropping your variables in, right, Tableau is now looking at the granularity that you're bringing in to the canvas itself. You could bring in different variables, and then Tableau starts aggregating those variables on that granularity. So for example, right now, what you see in front of you is essentially the sum of sales across different product categories. So what Tableau is essentially looking at is a granularity which is rolled up at the furniture level. When we break this down, the granularity becomes deeper, and then Tableau aggregates it back onto that granularity. Now, what happens essentially in doing so is there could be scenarios where you would want to look at data not at the granularity that is being shown in the visualization, but have the flexibility to govern or to at least get the kind of granularity that you want to bring in. So the level of detail calculations, what they essentially do is they go beyond what you are bringing in to the canvas. You can actually run the level of detail calculations on dimensions that you do not bring into the calculation, or you've brought those into calculation, but you don't want to use certain aspects of them to basically come at an aggregated figure. And that's what we're going to cover. And that's what we're going to cover today in the level of detail calculations. The level of detail calculations is basically broken into three family or three sections. The parent is called fixed, right? So if you actually go and search for fixed, this is the parent LOD calculation that you would use. And this is essentially, could be your starting point. If you don't get into include and exclude, which are the other two functions within the level of detail family of functions, fixed is essentially the one that covers most grounds when it comes to using an LOD calculation. Now, when you're using an LOD calculation, what you essentially have to remember is you are going to freeze a granularity, right? You're basically going to tell Tableau that, hey, irrespective of what I have on the canvas right now, irrespective of the dimension that I have on the canvas, the aggregation should happen on the expression that I'm going to build here. Now, anyone who comes with a SQL kind of a background, the way I would want you to think of this is a nested SQL code. What Tableau is essentially doing with an LOD calculation is running a nested SQL code. But if you're not somebody who comes with a SQL background and do not understand what a nested SQL code is, don't worry about it, right? I'm just going to take you through some steps to make you understand how the level of detail calculation works. And while doing so, you'll start getting a grasp of when, where, and how you could use some of these calculations. So to start with, what we will do is we'll work on this canvas that you're seeing right now. If you look at this particular visualization, and let me increase the font size so that all of you could see this a little better. Just give me 1 second. Yeah. Now, if you can look at this, what we're essentially doing is we are breaking down, and let me just roll this back. We're basically breaking down furniture into we're looking at sales getting aggregated at the three product segments that we are looking at right now. Now, let's bring in another variable in. I'm not going to drill down. I'm going to actually bring in another dimension, which is customer segment, right? So what happens now is essentially, because I've gotten another level or another dimension, the earlier figure that you were seeing got broken down or split into the customer segments that I've brought in. If I want to still go back and understand, what my furniture total was, I can actually go to analytics, bring my totals in and put it on column, right? Which gives me the grand total. I can also go back and activate subtotals, which then tells me the total for furniture in that segment. Now let's assume you want to calculate, or you want to freeze the furniture totals irrespective of the granularity that you start seeding in, right? So in a scenario like that, what you're essentially going to tell Tableau is, I want to bring in sales and I want to bring it at a level that has to be fixed at furniture, right? At that product category segment. So what you will essentially do is end up writing a quick, LOD expression. And that LOD expression could go something like this. And I'll break that LOD expression for you when I start building this out. So I want to basically look at sales at a category level, right? So what I'm going to do is whenever you start with a level of detail calculation, it'll always start with a floor bracket. Right, that's the indication that you're now going to use a LOD calculation. So like I said, I want to calculate sales and I want to calculate sales at the level of the product category that I'm bringing in. Irrespective of how the visualization gets split, the sales value should always be fixed at the category level. So I'm going to use the calculation fixed. I'm going to fix it on the product category, which is where I want to get the aggregation at that level. And then I'm going to run the aggregation here, which says sum of sales. Now, what this is essentially doing is saying that this sum of sales should happen at the product category level, right? This is what this means. Now, let me show you what happens when we bring this level of retail calculation into the canvas itself, right? Now, when I bring this into the canvas, what you will start seeing is this value, right? The 71 lakh value that you were seeing for total of furniture gets repeated for each row. And this is where Tableau is essentially saying, I don't care what granularity you bring in. I am going to freeze this at the subcategory level. So now, if I further drill down from a product category to a product subcategory level, and let me just do this as fit with, you will see whether while the sales value starts breaking down, the level of detail expression that I have written stays fixed, right? Stays the same. It does not change. So now, how would you use this? Why would you use this? We will go through those in some of the next exercises that I have, but let's move on and understand the other two functions that are available in the level of detail calculation, the include and the excludes, right? So let's first look at the exclude functionality, right? Now, just in the interest of time, I've written these calculations down already. So I'm just going to open those up, show those to you, and then we'll go through those. So the exclude, right, that we're going to use essentially says, and let me increase this size a little. What exclude essentially does is it basically says that if you bring in, you could bring in any level of dimensions in the visualization that you're building, but the aggregation that will happen will always exclude a certain dimension that is already part of the visualization, right? So here, for exclude to work, the dimension that we are excluding should ideally be part of the expression of the visualization itself. So if I now bring this in, right, and let me do that for you. If I bring exclude in, now what essentially happens is Tableau is now calculating these on the basis of the customer segment. And let me show you how that works. If I just bring in the customer segments, right, irrespective of bringing in the product category or not, these are the values that you would end up seeing, right, which is 42 lakhs, 76 lakhs, and stuff like that. So what Tableau is essentially doing is bringing those values in, right? So it's not taking into consideration the split of each of these variables, right, at the furniture level. So if you'll see all these numbers repeat, right? So you'll see these numbers repeating for every product category that you have, right? So when you look at exclude, what I'm then saying is, I don't care how this customer segment gets split. I just want you to freeze the calculation at the customer segment level itself, which essentially means that if I have, if I don't bring in product categories, and if I just bring my segment in, these are the numbers that you would see, right? So if you'll see, this is a simple visualization. I'm not doing any level of detail calculations. This is just a customer segment, and I just have my sum of sales. So what Tableau is doing when I'm doing an exclude here is essentially bringing those same values in by taking out the product category. Now, what happens if I bring in the subcategory, right, which is the drill down? Then you will actually see these numbers change, because what I'm essentially telling Tableau is, just don't bring this in, right? But if you start bringing in additional dimensions, I want you to still split that, right? So Tableau will still split that, but will always exclude this particular dimension from the calculation. That's what exclude does. Now, finally, the third one in the line is the include function. Now, exclude is where, you know, you basically say that, you know, if there is a there are a bunch of dimensions in my visualization, just take one out, two out, three out, whatever it is, right? So you can take multiple out as well by just, you know, having commas. Now, the include, essentially what it does is, it basically says that if you do not have a particular dimension, in this case, it's going to be region. Region is not part of this visualization, because what all we have is customer segment, and then we have product category and subcategory. So now what I'm essentially telling Tableau is, and I'm using average of sales just so that, you know, you can understand what's happening. So this time what I'm essentially telling Tableau is that for this particular visualization's calculation, also consider region. So when you give me the average of sales, split that at the background for region as well, right? So before I bring this in, let me show you what happens when we just bring the average sales value in. Right, so let's bring that average sales value in. And what you should see is that the average sales value is split across my furniture and customer segment. And if I drill down, essentially, you will see that drilling down and getting aggregated at that level as well. Now, when I bring in my include LOD, where I'm again telling Tableau that you now need two, and let me just bring them next to each other so that you can see them better. And let me just break this back here, right? You'll actually see that the averages are different, right? It's not the same. And the reason this is happening is, again, what Tableau is essentially doing is when it's breaking the region down, right? When it's breaking the, or when it's computing the average of sales, it is also bringing region into consideration, right? So for example, in this visualization, I have product category, I have customer segment and region. So Tableau actually brings in 21,442 for consumers without really having this region as a dimension in the calculation or the visualization itself. So now when you look at this, you actually see 21,442 here, you see 19,921 here, which in other words is this value for corporate. Right? So without really bringing in region into the visualization, what Tableau allows you to do with include is to bring in another dimension or a bunch of dimensions for you to finally get a value that you would want to see in the visualization. So the way you would want to use fixed, exclude, and include is very simple. You could use fixed all the time, right? There is no really a thumb rule for you to say that, you know, I should be using fixed only or in this particular calculation. You can use fixed whenever you want to, right? If you're in doubt, if you don't know what include or exclude is going to do, just go ahead, use fixed, right? And that will work perfectly. However, there will be scenarios from a performance perspective where we would ideally advise you to use include or exclude. And that is purely from a performance perspective. So if you build a visualization and you start noticing performance degradations, because level of detail calculations are resource intensive calculations, these are calculations. If you're connecting to your data, you know, get computed at the data level, and then, you know, is fetched back into Tableau Canvas, right? So that is how the query pipeline moves. So level of detail calculations are costlier from a performance perspective. So to improve their performance, you could actually use include or exclude as the case may be, right? So that is where you could choose one from the other. But in case you still confused and you don't know, just go ahead, use fixed. If you start seeing performance degradations, then you can choose include or exclude depending on your use case and see if this gives you some kind of a upliftment. Now, that's the basic concept of level of detail calculations. What I'm going to do next is essentially bring some use cases in so that you start relating to how these can be used. So the first one is a very, very simple use case, right? And let me take this out. I'm sorry for that, right? What we are essentially doing here is we have our customers, right, who have been buying, products from us, right? So for example, if you look at Akash has gone ahead and bought, you know, different products from us or placed orders from us across different dates. Now, what I essentially want to figure out in this particular use case is, what is the first purchase date, right, for all my customers? Depending on who my customer is, can I know what their first purchase date is? So what that essentially means is, I don't want so many dates. I just want the date when they purchased the first time. Now, when you have that kind of a requirement, what you're essentially trying to do is, you're basically trying to figure out a min of date, but that min of date should apply at the customer level, right? That is what you're trying to get out. So what we'll do here is, again, write a quick calculation, right? And we'll call this the first date of purchase per customer, right? And let me just tag this as 04 because we're making these calculations right now. And here, what we'll do is we will create a calculation. Again, like I said, open up your flower brackets. Let's say fixed. I'm going to fix this at the customer name because what we want to figure out is what is the minimum date for each customer. So it has to be fixed at the customer level. And then it, you know, you need to put in a colon and then you basically bring in your, min of order date. A level of detail calculation will always require an aggregation. You could not run this without an aggregation. Level of detail calculation, even if you are writing a conditional statement where you're trying to, your output is not a measure or a number, but a dimension, you will still have to aggregate that, right? And typically the way we aggregate dimensions is using min or max, depending on what your use case could be. But ideally you could use either and you could still have to aggregate it, right? So you can still write level of detail calculations yielding a dimension output, but you will still have to aggregate it. Now, when I basically put this in and I look at this particular new calculation that has come up, let's bring that in. And what we're going to do is look at it at the discrete level. And what you will see on your screens is that Tableau basically brings in the first date for each customer, right? So if I start scrolling down, or for that matter, if I just remove this order date, for each customer, I can now see what their first purchase order date was, right? So this could be a scenario where you're trying to get the first date for a transaction, or for example, my next use case, which talks about a cohort analysis. And a cohort analysis is something that most organizations do to understand certain patterns based on when a particular portfolio was sourced. This could be at a transaction level, it could be at at purchase history level, whatever it is. So what we essentially want to do here in this particular example is figure out that across all the different years that I have and the sales that I generated in each of those years, can I look at the contribution of sales based on when a customer, you know, came on board? So for example, if Prashant first shopped on Amazon way back in 2011, Amazon wants to understand that, does Prashant shop with me again? And if he does, what is the contribution of revenue that all those people who first shopped with me in 2011 still exist with me, right? So it's essentially from a customer stickiness perspective. So what we're going to do here is very similar to what we did here, which is basically to find out the first date of purchase. But essentially, I'm doing a cohort. So what I want to get as an output is a simple year output of the min date. So I'm going to create a calculation field again. And this time what I'm essentially going to do is create a calculation. And I'm just going to copy paste the calculation that I have at my end, which is this one. Sorry, the other one. So here, what I'm essentially now doing is the exact same calculation that I ran the last time. The only addition thing that I'm doing here is basically saying that whatever the minimum order date is, just bring in the year as well, right? And nothing more. So once I bring in this year, right? And I can call this as customer cohort. And let's call this as 05. Right now. This becomes a measure, but we're going to quickly move this as a dimension because what I'm essentially wanting to do is flag these off as a contribution. Now what I can do is I can bring my cohort to the color, right? So you can now start seeing what is a contribution in each of the years by people who first purchased, you know, in 2011, 2012, 13, 14, and so on. Now, this is not complete as a calculation, as a visualization. What I would essentially want to do here is look at their contribution. This does not give me a contribution at this point. It just gives me you know, a distribution within a particular year. For me to figure out what that contribution is, I'm going to quickly do a quick table calculation. We're going to cover table calculations in a while. Essentially what I'm going to do here is do a percent of total and give Tableau the reference as to how this percent of total needs to be calculated. Now, if I go ahead and bring the values or the labels in, I can now see, you know, how that contribution increases. So for example, customers who first bought in 2012, I can see what their contribution in subsequent years is as well, right? So what I can do in a cohort analysis is fix the year in which the customer first bought it and then bring that as part of my visualization as well. Now, the next use case that I have is basically to figure out, right? So Tableau essentially gives you an option of creating histograms, right? So if you go ahead and select a particular measure, what Tableau will always give you is an option. And let me do that on an empty sheet, otherwise you won't see it, is an option to create a histogram, right? So this is where Tableau is essentially, you know, binning, you know, values itself. It gives you the flexibility to do that. But what if you basically want to create your own bins and you want to see how the customers are spread across those bins? So what we're going to essentially do here is figure out how many of my customers, right, fall into different order bin buckets, which is how many of my customers have only shopped with me once, how many of my customers have shopped with me 10 times, 20 times, 30 times, whatever it is. So we're going to use LODs again. And this time what we're going to do is when we create the LOD expression, we are again going to fix this on the customer level. But this time when we're going to fix it on customer level, so let me first bring this as customer order bin, right? Let's just call this our account bin. And now when I bring in this expression, what I'm essentially telling Tableau is to give me the count distinct of my order IDs per customer, right? So I'm now building an expression where the end output is going to be the number of orders that a customer has generated, and then just bring all of those as part of my visualization. So when I run this calculation, and let me use this as 06, if I'm not wrong, this is the one. And again, just move this to dimensions. And when I bring this to rows, what you'll essentially see a kind of a histogram. Let's just swap the axis. right? But these bins have now been created based on a calculation that you've written. And what this is essentially telling you is that there are 231 customers who bought from me at least six times, right? Or bought from me six times. So the maximum that I see here is an order count of eight. So there are customers who've the highest number of transaction histories that I've had with my customers is eight orders, and that is with 251 customers. So with the level of detail calculation, what we're essentially doing is fixing and bringing the count distinct values of each customer at the order ID level. Now, here, if you would have noticed when we did the cohort analysis, we also used something called as table calculations. Now, just like LODs, and let's get back here, just like LODs, table calculations also help you do the analysis. But one of the biggest caveats for you to write a table calculation or to use a table calculation is that Tableau will only use the data or the dimensions that form part of the canvas. So only and only if you bring in a dimension into the Tableau canvas will a table calculation work. So what Tableau essentially does in the backend is create this as a table. And whatever calculations you write, Tableau does not consider with, what's coming from the data source, what's there in the data source. What it essentially works on is temporary tables that Tableau creates at the backend for the elements that you have brought into the canvas. Table calculations are fairly fast because they work at on the front end of Tableau. So there are times when you can actually use table calculations in place of level of detail calculations. So there are a lot of scenarios that you will come across once you start understanding how table calculations and LODs work, where you can actually use both of them interchangeably. And from a performance perspective, table calcs are faster, but from a flexibility of designing a use case, LODs are far, far ahead. Like I said, table calcs require that the elements be brought in, and only once you bring those elements in does it really work. Now, how do table calculations work, right? So let's first quickly understand those. And for that, what I've done is I have already created this table, right? And what we're going to do is understand first how table calculations work. Now, under the umbrella of table calculations, if you again go to our calculated fields, you can actually see a family of table calculations, right? Which is right here. So these are all different table calculations that you can use in Tableau, right? To basically create your own expression. But there are certain table calcs that Tableau also gives you, which are called quick table calculations. These are pre-configured expressions that Tableau has built in that you can quickly use. And these are some very commonly used calculations that you can just click and start seeing on your visualizations. Now, the most important thing for you to understand when you use table calculations is how a table calculation is executed. We're going to use a very simple use case first, and then we'll go from there. So what we will do is do a very simple percent of total. But before we do that, let me bring my totals in so that you start understanding what Tableau is doing at the backend. So we're going to bring in the totals. We're going to add this to columns. We're also going to add this to rows. And we are also going to add these to subtotals, right? Now, a table calculation, like I said, will always work on the values or the measures that you've brought in. So here, if I now change this to, let's assume, percent of total, right? There's a very simple calculation that even if you don't use Tableau and Excel could easily do this for you. Now, when you use a percent of total, what Tableau is essentially doing, and let me increase the font size here again, just give me 1 second. Yeah. So when I ran the table of, when I ran the table calculation, what Tableau did was use the calculation horizontally. So what Tableau is essentially saying is for each line item that you have, for each row that you have, I will compute this percentage of total for each row. if your use case does not require this, but you actually want to understand that what is the contribution of furniture, right, in the year of 2011, then what you're essentially doing is you don't want it to be computed horizontally, you want it to be computed vertically. So what you'll essentially do is go to compute using and use table down, right? And that calculation then changes. However, what if you don't want to use it across all the different segments, but you want to confine it to each region? You would then start changing it for what values these are. Now, one of the ways for you to understand how Tableau is doing this, if this becomes a little confusing for you, is to click on the edit table calculations, right? Now, when you look at the edit table calculations, what Tableau does is it gives you visual cues how this calculation is going to get executed, right? So if you click on each of these, Tableau is essentially telling you that this is the section on which I'm going to execute this calculation. It's extremely important that you understand how a table calculation gets computed. Because if you don't, then there are chances that you will come up with results that are incorrect without realizing that those results are incorrect, especially if you have a lot of data that you're working with. The other way of looking at this is essentially looking at another way, which is you could also control this by specifying the dimensions on which this calculation gets executed. Now, if you click on specific dimensions, the way you have to look at this is bottom up. What you're essentially going to do is look at the granularity, right? And then see what is getting computed at what level, right? So here, what we're essentially doing is we are computing sales at the product category level, right? Which is getting rolled up from your region and then to the product category level. Right, so that is where it's important. So in case you don't, in case you want Tableau to understand what that is, the best thing to do is first to select how you want to do this. And if you'll see at the back end, the specific dimensions start to change, right? And then once you have the granularity that you've selected, you could select specific dimensions and freeze that. Once you've frozen this, then irrespective of any changes that you make, for example, right here, even if I move this around, right? And let's bring this here. The granularity still remains the same, right? Tableau would not change the way those numbers are being calculated. So in case you want the view to change, but the granularity with the expression is getting computed to remain the same, you can then specify, what the calculation should run on. So what are some of the areas where you could be using quick table calculations or table calculations? The most frequent usage that you will come across is calculations related to time. Tableau is extremely powerful when it comes to building visualizations, especially on time. It lets you break down dates both in discrete and continuous manner. In case you are someone new, it's extremely important that you understand how this grid works and how Tableau uses dates either in discrete or continuous manner. So there's a lot of material out there. It'll be very productive if you actually go and read upon how Tableau uses discrete versus continuous date ranges, and that can really help you understand how to use Tableau better. So here, in case I wanted to use a very simple year-over-year growth calculation, I don't have to go back and write that expression out all over again. I could just go click on year over year growth. And what Tableau is essentially doing at the back end is writing this expression. And let me bring that out for you so that it's nice and big, right? Just let me bring this here, right? So this expression is something that Tableau has written at the back end already. Right. If you want to understand how this expression is being written, Tableau is using certain table calculations at the back end to do this. Lookup is a function that you could use either to lag or to advance a particular measure or a dimension in that way. If you basically negate a lookup, it's basically lagging it. And if you use a positive integer, you're basically going to advance it, right? So Tableau essentially here is using this expression where it's calculating this on the back end and it's letting you do these calculations all by yourself, right? So quick table calculations are a way for you to really get these out very, very quickly. You can always at any point in time not use a visualization and use a table. So Tableau allows you to do all of that, right, which can easily be done, right? So that's available. So you could use quick table calculations to essentially get these outputs out really, really quickly. Now, another use case could be where you essentially create a visualization and you want to understand what falls above or below a certain measure value. In this case, what I'm essentially taking is the average line, right? The average line can be plotted from the analytics tab. You could just bring in the average line and plot that here. So what we are essentially doing is figuring out an average line. And here what I want to do is to basically color code or flag off any of my product subcategories that are lesser than my average, my overall average. So what I'm going to do here is create a calculation, and I'm going to break this calculation down for you. The first thing that we're going to do is create a calculation, which basically gives me all the values as a common average value for the entire table that we're bringing in, right? So we will call this as a window average. That's literally the function that I'm going to use. And what we're going to do here is we're going to use window average, wherein I'm going to do a sum of sales in there. And now this becomes a table calculation, and we're going to bring the window average as part of my visualization again, right? So if I want to show you the number values, so if you'll see this 12 million coincides with the average value here. Now what I essentially want to do is create a flag, right? So let me take this out. I want to now create a flag which helps me look at the values which are greater than or lesser than a certain value. So all I'm going to do is say sum less than sum of sales, right? Now this becomes a average sales average flag, sorry. And when I bring this out in, right, let's do that. And you'll see the sales average flag, where did it go? Right here, right? So it becomes a Boolean expression. Now, if I bring this into my visualization, I can see all the values that are true being orange and all the values which are less than my average going down, right? So this is my average line, right? So I can see all the blue ones which are below the average and all the orange ones which are above the average, right? So I could use table calcs to do something like this and also look at, how different elements could be impacted basis, the analysis that I'm doing. There are two more use cases that we can look at. I'm not going to build those out for now, but just show you very, very quickly. Rather, this one, I can actually build it out for you. Another, and you can actually see this, as many different tutorials that are out there. What if you actually want to understand, how your measure values changed or what the trajectory over the different years was. What I'm essentially talking about is if I want to understand or rank each of my profit values across different years and understand how their movement was in terms of the region, right? Which region was most profitable in a particular year and which was the least profitable, right? While I can do that visually, there's a certain kind of a chart, which is called a bump chart that can be used for this. And the way a bump chart can be created is essentially using the rank function, all right? It's again a table calculation that you could use. And here, because I want to rank this basis my region, I'm going to fix this on region. So basically what I'm trying to do is rank my profit basis of region, and I'm going to fix this on region. And you can start seeing the different values that keep coming up, but just so that I can plot this out a little better, I'm going to change this from a continuous to a discrete. And now if you look at some of these values, you could actually see that the central dropped from being fairly profitable in 2011 to 2012, to be dropping down places in all the different regions. So in case you want to compare different regions in terms of how they have performed, a bump chart is a very, very good representation for you to do that. Another analysis that you can build using table calculations is a Pareto or an 80-20 or a ABC analysis. What we can do is quickly build this out as well. I'll take another 2 minutes and then we can have Q&A after this. So the way Aperito gets built is essentially, or rather for us to first understand why you would build Aperito, is basically understand what contributes. So basically, if I'm going to look at, in this case, my different stores, so I basically want to understand what percentage of my stores contribute most to my profit, right? I have different stores across different regions, and I know not all of them contribute in the same revenue range. So if I want to figure out what my stores, how many of my stores contribute to most of my profit, a Pareto or an 80-20 or an ABC analysis can be quickly built. So what we're going to do here is very quickly do that, which is essentially first bring in the profit item across each of my stores. I'm going to sort this for now. And then what I'm going to do is, because for the Pareto, I want to understand what is the contribution of my stores, yielding from highest to least. We're going to sum this profit first, so we're going to use a running total. I'm going to minimize the view. I'm going to fit this. You'll start seeing a curve, right? Then what I'm going to do is add another layer to this calculation, because what we essentially want is not numbers, but the contribution of each store. So I'm going to now bring in a secondary calculation, right? And in this calculation, I'm going to use a percent of total. And what I'm going to do is specify both the calculations specifically on the store name. The next thing that I want to do, right? So this gives me basically my, that 80 out of the 80-20, this becomes my 80% line. So if I add a reference line here, this becomes the line that I'm looking at, wherein I want to understand, how many of my stores contribute to 80% of my performance. So I can clearly see that all these stores that are here and below are the ones that are contributing to 80%, right? And then the line basically starts to flatten out. Finally, what I'm also going to do is create another calculation, which I've already built, wherein I'm going to have my stores also broken down into percentage forms, right? So basically, I'm going to bring this out, right? And what I'm going to do is take the stores out into detail, and I'm going to use, or rather change, the quick table calculation to the store name. And the most important aspect here is basically to sort the store names basis my profit, right? Because what we're essentially trying to do here is look at what stores are the most profitable, right? Basically, I'm telling Tableau that the sum of stores based on profit is what needs to get it sorted on. And then I can bring in my line, and then this becomes the 20% of my stores, which essentially yields me that contribution. So just give me one second, and this is it. So what I'm essentially doing with an 80-20 analysis again is looking at all these different stores that you see here. So these are all the stores that contribute to about, if you just hover on this, to about 60%, right? 20% of my stores contribute to 60% of my profitability. And the reason this has come up is because I'm sorting my stores on the basis of profitability, right? That's the reason it's very important that when you're creating a Pareto, whatever your x-axis is, it has to be sorted on the measure value that you're building the analysis on, and it has to be sorted in a descending order. So there are different use cases for which you could use table calculations. There are different use cases for which you could use level of retail calculations. What you have to remember is the way Tableau treats the granularity is very different in a table calculations versus an LOD. An LOD will always work on elements that you bring into the visualization, whereas a level of detail calculation can actually work on details that are no longer part of the visualization, right? So for in this case, for example, we do not have the date here, but Tableau still went ahead and identify the first date of purchase for each customer. So depending on what your use case is, you could use either. And depending on the performance parameters also, you could use one from the other. If performance is not a challenge, LODs are a great way to go because it gives you flexibility of creating visualizations. Whereas LODs are far faster and can actually create some visualizations that do not require a certain way of representation, right? I know this was fairly quick. What we'll do after this session is, share some resources that you could look at. I'm going to share those with Lakshya, and Lakshya can put that out, right? And you can go fall back and look at some of these analysis. There's enough material on both LODs and quick table calculations out there, both by Tableau and by community members. So it's one of the older ones. The only thing that I want to leave you with is, we now have something called as relationships. I'm not too sure if of the users that are already on Tableau, if you were able to do this, but relationships are also going to impact your usage of LODs. There will be use cases where you will no longer require using LODs because relationships will actually on the fly understand what the joining conditions are and yield the output basis, the visualizations that you're building. So relationships is also a great way for you to work on granularity. I have not kept that as part of our discussion this time, but in case in the future, as a forum, if you ever want to understand how relationships work, please let us know and we would be more than happy to come and talk to you about relationships as well. Right. With that, I'm going to stop my session and Lakshya, back to you.
Thank you, Prashant. I think this was very useful. There are two questions which I can see on the chat window. I hope we can take that now.
Hey, sorry, I was on mute.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to start. Yeah, so I'm going to start with Bharat's question because I believe the one before that is not LOD or quick table related. So we'll come back to that as well if required. So do LOD support different data sources in Tableau? Can we write LOD calculations with different data sources? Yes, you can. Essentially, what happens is it depends on whether you're connecting live or in extract mode. If you're connecting in an extract mode, you can write LOD calculations irrespective of the data source it's coming from. There are some data sources, especially if you're connecting live, that would not support LOD calculations. For example, if you're connecting to a cube data source, LODs are not supported there. But then there are certain data sources which do not support certain calculations in Tableau, right? There's a checkbox or a checklist in there. And if you go and actually search in our online help section, you'll actually see what those data sources are, right? I hope Bharat gets some clarity on that. Shaunak basically is asking, can that flag off chart be done by using reference lines, highlighting bars which are below the reference lines? Yes, you can do that as well. You can do that by sets as well. Absolutely, right? I was just showing one way of doing it. The most interesting aspect about Tableau is there is not one way of achieving an outcome. There are multiple ways for you to build visualizations using different techniques in Tableau. I just showed that as a table calculation, but you can absolutely use sets to do that. Rather, with the new set actions, there's a lot more dynamic capabilities that have been brought in. So you could use that also. Okay. Then there was another question saying, why is this going above 100%? That's only because of the resolution. Tableau essentially tries to fit that in. If you look at this, it will not. So there is some value that's a little above 100%, but then this is all junk data. So don't worry on that. But ideally, it will limit itself to 100% as well. Can you explain what is the difference between total and window sum functions? It depends on the use case. What total essentially does is, again, depending on how your table is going to be structured, total and window sum would differ. It's very difficult for me to look at. So window, for example, can be broken down again by the table or the visualization that's getting built. And that is how you could use one from the other. Plus the Windows sum would essentially have another layer of calculation built in. Total will essentially give you, the total for the entire table, right? So Windows sum will give you certain more flexibilities of doing that. Okay. Nisarg wants to know how it could benefit. Okay.
I think Caroline.
Yeah. So. I'm not too sure if I can answer that. I'm going to skip for that. But analytics in general is an exciting career avenue to be in today. Tableau, no Tableau, right? If you are somebody who is associated with this, it's the place to be in. Tableau is one of the platforms in the analytics bucket that you could learn. But there's a lot of depth in terms of using analytical softwares, for that matter, you don't really need anything. If you know how to, code in R, Python, that's a good way to start as well. And in case you are somebody who does not come from that kind of a background, then business intelligence, products like Tableau can actually help you at least, be on the diagnostic and the descriptive side of analytics, if not the advanced analytics side, right? So definitely Tableau is a product that you could learn. There's a lot of free resources out there. So definitely you can do that. What am I missing? Okay, so Madhumita and Rajat, I am not in a position to start building things out right now, again, in the interest of time. There are examples that we can share with you. These are simple examples. We'll share those with you so that you can, check this out at your end at leisure. I'm going to go to Shaunak's question. I was just curious to know which are the most used table calculation industry by Tableau professionals, and would the new relationship feature minimize LOD use? Shaunak, the answer is it will not minimize. So there is no way for us to quantify whether it will minimize or maximize. What it essentially is giving you is another way. Again, right? Like I said, there are multiple ways for you to use Tableau, or rather do things in Tableau, and relationships is now just one more way for you to address your business requirements. There will still be a lot of scenarios where you would still want to use LOD calculations. Rather, there are a lot of scenarios, even if you go through some of the tutorials that we have out there, where you could use both level of detail expressions along with multi-relationship models that you will build in. So they'll actually go hand in hand. And it truly depends on the kind of use case that you have, that you might now have another capability where you no longer have to write level of detail calculations for some very basic and simple aggregations, right? Relationships are going to take care of that. But like I said, there will be scenarios where you will still end up using LODs along with a logical model that gets built up, right? So I hope that helps. Okay, I don't know whether I keep missing or I keep getting questions that get preceded over that. Okay. For the table calcs, what does three options at the level restarting every? Okay. So Gurpreet, it depends, again, depending on how you want to create your table calculation. So for example, let's just go here, all right? It depends on the kind of analysis that you're doing, which then essentially helps you tell Tableau where the expression or the calculation needs to switch back or roll back. So depending on, again, what your analysis is, you might choose one from the other. Sort orders are also extremely important. If you remember when I was talking about especially this particular analysis, is that gone? Yeah. Right here, let me show you this, right? So when you are using table calculations, this is, and if you remember, I said it typically goes, bottom to up. So if you start moving this around, right, the order in which some of these calculations could work do get affected as well. So depending on what your outcomes is, there is a possibility that you will change some of these settings to basically get the desired output, right? And that's where for Tableau, the referenceability part is, for table calculations, the referenceability part is extremely important. You need to tell table calculations in Tableau how they need to be computed. And that's the reason you would tweak some of these things out, again, depending on your use case, right? There's some guidance out there, but most of it is going to happen when you're creating your use cases, especially with the calculations granularity that you desire Tableau to achieve, right? And that's where you'll start changing them.
I think videos.
I think there should be a lot of them out there. Yeah, I think if you go and search for stuff, Santosh, if you check our free training videos, or if you go to YouTube, you'll find a lot of videos with different aspects of being covered. What I encourage everyone to do is actually seek some of our Tableau conference videos. There's a lot of good content that we cover there, which you will actually not see as part of our free training videos or as part of some of the other YouTube channels that are out there. Anything related to calculations, visualizations, I highly encourage that you check out our feeds for the Tableau conference videos. There's a lot of good content in there, and some of this could be there. Plus, you could actually look at some of the content that is published by our Jedis that are there on Tableau Public. They also put in a lot of videos on YouTube, so that should be a good place for you to look at as well. Shaunak is asking, would it be wrong to say that a secondary table calculation is used in cases where Viz involves a dual access? Not exactly, because in this case, when I was creating a Pareto, there was no dual access. There was a calculation that was required on top of the running total calculation that we did. So what we essentially did was we first carried out a running total calculation, and then we converted that as a percentage of total, right? And that's where that came in. A secondary axis would essentially mean that the measure that you're plotting on the secondary axis will have its own table calc if that is required. A secondary calculation would essentially run on the same measure because you want to now, further, compute something on it. So I use percentage of total. There will be scenarios where you would also want to, for example, use moving averages. So one of those things that you can actually do is use moving averages to do this as well. Rajat is asking, in future, will we get how? Get updated from
the session.
Okay. Yeah. So yeah. That's all yours.
Yeah. So probably hopefully you would have got a mail this time. Other way around, what you can do is you can reach out to any one of us directly, and what we'll do, we'll probably add you to the groups on LinkedIn or WhatsApp, where we are publishing about these sessions, and from there we can probably share whatever sessions are upcoming. Okay, so what I'll do now is, Prashant, there was one question regarding Tableau certification on the chat. So okay. What Bhagyashree is asking is Tableau certification necessary?
Okay, so I don't know how to put that across. I am not Tableau certified. Let me start off with that. But is it necessary? It depends. Honestly speaking, it depends. It's a good thing to have. That's what I truly believe in. If you are somebody who's spending a lot of time using Tableau in your work, and if you are fairly confident about your capabilities, it is something that you can invest in. Please be aware that Tableau certifications have a validity, especially if it's not the first one that's there in the list. But typically, most Tableau certifications have a validity of about 2 years or so. Like I said, I'm not Tableau certified, but then again, a lot of people within the Tableau India team are. I know there are people within the technical team itself who are Tableau certified. So it's a good thing to have. My only submission there is if your organization is going to sponsor it, then you know, obviously then there's nothing like it. But if it's something that you want to personally invest in, my strong suggestion is each certification comes with some guidance on what your experience level should be. Please consider that. You have a lot of people out there in the community who actually share their experiences of certifications. You can find those experiences on LinkedIn. You can find those experiences, on community posts, blog posts, and stuff like that. My strong suggestion is go look at that. And if you have to put your money in, please be very sure that you're going to clear it, right? And then put your money in. Even if it's your company's money, please do that. But essentially, be aware of what you're getting into, because some advanced certifications are not straightforward. They're not simple. Tableau certifications are really valued in the market. So my suggestion would be look at the guidances for the experience level that it calls out. Prepare very, very well. Look at some of the experiences that others have and then take it from there. Okay, I can see Bhagyashree also typing in something. Just give me 1 second. Yeah, so can you please elaborate about Tableau e-learning? If I will have all badges from that, how will it help me crack the interview? I don't know. Honestly speaking, I don't know what the interviewer is going to really ask you. But I think it will definitely help if you actually go through our e-learning, with in spirit, right? And then not from a perspective of just, as a checklist, just go through those. Our e-learning is fairly strong. It can actually really help you build your skills. So I think depending on, the job interview going from, questions could vary, but from what I know from the industry, typically when you are being hired as a Tableau developer, they will definitely give you a challenge, right? And Lakshay, maybe, you can share something, or Avdesh, you can share something from your own organization experiences. Typically what organizations do when they hire Tableau developers is they might give them a challenge to crack. They sometimes do it as part of their process. They sometimes just give you the use case and ask you to, develop something and come in. But there's definitely, some checks that they will do to ensure what your capabilities are. So e-learnings could really help you. But again, it depends on, how the employer interprets your badges and what your, level of preparedness is. So I really can't comment on it. But yeah, if you do that in spirit, I think that should really help you crack your interviews, especially when you have to develop something as part of the interview process.
I think we are good with the questions. I can see one any points on upcoming Iron West in attempts. Probably what I could suggest is go through past challenges as well. Go through what has been done before. Some of the technical things would be really useful to you. Prashant, want to add on?
So I'm the worst person to add on to this. I've never been part of a YNWiz. So I think you guys are better equipped to handle this. Tableau employees, we can't enter YNWiz, right? So yeah, knock yourself out.
Yeah. So yeah, adding on to the Lakshya's points, I certainly second by his thoughts and previous year's challenges and moreover, the implementations by the winners as well as the participants can certainly guide you on what level of challenge it is and how exactly your skills and creativity can let you become a part of it. So yeah, that's what you can go ahead and check it out.
Okay, so we are done with all the questions. So thank you guys. Thank you, Prashant. Thank you, Avdesh, for today's useful sessions. What I'll do now is I'll just share my screen and put on all the contacts on the screen. Also, we'll be sharing the presentations today or the content which we covered today with a mail later sometime next week. This session's video would be published on YouTube on Monday or Tuesday under Tableau's channel itself. Just let me share my screen with the contacts as well. So you can get in touch if you need any other information or if you want to discuss anything related to Tableau or data visualization as a whole. So I think we can wind up for today. Thank you, Abdesh. Thank you, Prashant.
Thanks, Lakshya. Thanks, everyone. Thanks
for Lakshya. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye. Have a nice day.
Bye. I'll just keep my screen share on for a minute or so, so that we can know that. Okay, thank you guys. Thank you for attending today's session. Have a nice weekend.